City University Television. In association with the Center for Advanced Study in Theater Arts. And the Harold Klerman Endowment. Presents Spotlight.
Welcome to Spotlight. I'm Ed Wilson, and my guest is a well-known theater producer and entrepreneur, Mr. Rocco Landesman. Rocco, welcome.
Thanks, Ed. Thanks for having me.
I'm glad you're here. Rocco, you had several careers, I think, before you actually got in the theater. Isn't that correct?
I'm a professional dilettante.
No, you're not. What were some of your careers before you got in the theater?
Well, I started out as a professor at the Yale School of Drama.
But so you were in theater there?
In a manner of speaking, although I was really on the academic side.
Right.
I was teaching dramatic literature and criticism, doing a little work with the resident company there as a dramaturg, but mostly I was on the academic end of things. And then I left Yale and did a couple of very oddball things. I started a mutual fund,
right,
stock market investments, and I developed a string of racehorses that I maintained out at Belmont Park. And
are you still an investor in racehorses?
No, but I'm still an investor in the stock market. I didn't need the racehorses anymore once I got involved in producing theater.
Isn't there a certain affinity between gambling on racehorses and gambling on shows on Broadway?
The key figure is about 15%. That's the percentage of winning horses and winning shows.
Are they really very much the same?
Yeah, they're very similar. 15% of the horses on the grounds of a racetrack actually earn their keep over the course of a year, and about 15% of all shows produced earn their money back. So just about exactly the same.
That's fascinating.
Incredibly.
Well, do you feel a certain, I know it's quite different in a lot of ways, but do you feel you're doing, in terms of trying to guess things or pick a thoroughbred, or you feel you're doing some of the same?
I feel it's pretty much the same thing. I mean, it's always a gamble and a speculation. And the joy of it, the excitement is being proved right.
In other words, backing a winner.
Yes, exactly.
Now, before you, we want to come to your current job, which is running the Jew Jamson Theater chain here in New York. But before we come to that, you produced a couple of Broadway shows, Big River and Into the Woods.
Right.
How did you get into producing then?
Well, Big River was a complete accident. I had had this lifelong passion for Roger Miller, the country singer,
right,
and songwriter. And one day we were in the car, my wife Heidi and I, to watch a Roger Miller concert at the Lone Star Cafe. And Heidi thought, gee, wouldn't it be great to do a musical with Roger Miller? And I thought, a musical with Roger Miller? That sounds odd.
He'd never done a Broadway show.
Never done one. He'd never seen one.
You mean he'd never seen one at
no.
all?
No. And I remember when I first broached the idea to him, he thought I was, you know, smoking something. I mean, he thought it was the most peculiar idea. I had to explain to him really what it was. But Heidi had the idea that Roger would be perfect for my favorite novel, which is The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, that he had the same voice, really. He spoke in the same vernacular and wrote in the same vernacular his songs that Twain did. And it turns out, for my money anyway, it was a perfect fit.
We should back up one second and say you've referred to Heidi. And
yes,
this is your wife, Heidi Landesman, who is a scene designer for...
And producer.
And producer, but scene designer on Broadway, off Broadway, and around the country. And
yes,
you all produced together.
We did Big River together, very much together, and she designed it.
Right.
In fact, she won two Tony Awards for the show. I only got one as producer. She won a Tony as the set designer and the producer.
And the producer.
Yes.
And then, of course, because that had a life on Broadway, and then it had a life
traveling
around the country.
It's still out around the country.
Is it really?
Yes, it's playing in St. Louis as we speak, and I expect it to have a further life. It's had a wonderful long run in Australia, and I expect that show to go on forever.
That's
it's
terrific.
It's been
well,
it's
something very basic about it, as you say, and very Americana too.
I think so.
And then you did Into the Woods, of course, is a Steve Sondheim musical based on fairy tales.
Yes, that was a little different. It was wonderful to be able to work with James Lapine and Stephen Sondheim. It was a little different experience for us in that it wasn't a show that we originated as the producers. It was really originated by the creative team. They came to us to get it onto Broadway, and we were kind of we didn't have the same relationship to it as we did with Big River, which was a show that we thought up, created, hired all the people to do, and really were involved in every step of the way.
It must be a tremendous thrill.
It is. And producing isn't done that way very much anymore. It used to be done that way all the time, where the producer would think up the idea, hire all the creative team, supervise every aspect of the production. Now it's much more frequent that the creative people will develop a show to a certain point and then go to a producer to really move it or present it somewhere.
This really brings up the whole subject of the Broadway theater and its relationship to
such as it is.
Such as it is. And well, we want to get to that, and its relationship to the regional theater, because so many of the plays, I know one of the plays that played in one of your theaters, the Walter Kerr Theater, was The Piano Lesson by August Wilson. That originated at the Yale Repertory Theater and other places around the country, and then it came into Broadway. That's what you're referring to when you say that producers on Broadway rarely now originate the whole package.
They do. Very often they start out in resident theaters, as The Piano Lesson did, and the Broadway producer then really is a presenter of someone else's work. In fact, in that case, the Broadway producer didn't even produce the original show. He really is presenting someone else's production. There are also situations in which the creative team will put together a show, develop the music, the lyrics, collaborate among themselves, and get that to a point where the producer can, in fact, produce it, but he wasn't really involved in creating it the way producers have historically done.
In the past, of course, traditionally, because the producer really put the whole thing together so often in past years.
Exactly.
That's before. I do want to talk about the state of Broadway. We should say first, though, that your job, after you were an independent producer, you became the manager, the president of Jew Jamson Theaters. And we should explain that Jew Jamson is an unusual name. It's really three names, isn't it? The first couple of, the first syllable of three names?
The owner of the company, Jim Binger, his three children, Judy, James, and Cynthia. That's how you got
so it's Jew Jamson.
Yes, and it's been fun. It's the first time I ever had a desk job.
Let me ask you this. This is a theater chain. It's the third largest, and there are only three.
Well, really, the smallest.
It's the third largest. Well, let's say it's the third largest.
Okay, fine.
Of Broadway theater chains, there's the Schubert Group, which is the largest, the Niederlander, which is second, and your group, which is five theaters, I mm-hmm. think you have.
Yes.
And the St. James, the Martin Beck, the Walter Kerr we mentioned.
And Eugene O'Neill and the Virginia.
And the Virginia. And you've been, in the last year or two, you've been very fortunate because they've been very active. I mean, in the 1990-91 season, you've had those theaters fairly full.
The job's a lot more fun when the theaters are booked.
I can imagine. Well, now, when you were approached to be president of Jew Jamson, were you surprised and did you think about it, or was it because, did it come out of the blue?
Well, two different questions. Yes, I was very surprised. No, I didn't think about it very much once I was asked. I immediately said, yeah, I'm going to go for this. It sounds like a great challenge.
But you didn't anticipate it, did you?
Not at all. Not at all. We had done, both of our shows were in the process of doing Into the Woods, and we had done Big River in Jew Jamson houses. But it's funny, I didn't get to know Jim Binger, who was the owner of the company, through the theater as much as through the racetrack.
Oh,
he's
yeah.
It's not one of those oddball things. He's been the owner of Tartan Farms, which is one of the largest and most successful racing and breeding operations in the country. And we would go to the track together. And that's how we got to know each other and became friends. And one day he asked me to lunch in New York, and he said, I've been having problems with my company. Would you be interested in taking it over and running it? And I said, you bet.
And it was just like that?
Yeah.
And so and it's been fun, hasn't it?
It's been great. I've had a ball. Now I can't imagine doing anything else.
Well, now tell me, let's talk about the state of the theater, particularly the New York theater, the Broadway theater, because it's been in...
Tough business.
It's a tough business. It's also been in terrible shape compared to past years.
But we always say that. I mean, it's declining business.
That's right.
But it's been declining since Aristophanes. I mean, isn't there some law of physics that if you get halfway to a destination,
right.
you keep taking half, you'll never get there. I think we're never going to get to the point where we have no Broadway theater. But it's worrisome because it does seem that it's... The peaks of the cycle keep getting lower and the troughs deeper. And it is a concern. There always will be a Broadway theater, of course, but it's become more and more precarious and tougher financially to make things go here.
What are the biggest problems, Rocco, facing producers like you and theater owners and producers and other people involved in the theater?
The two biggest things, of course, are the cost of production, which have escalated almost out of control. The Secret Garden, which is a new musical that we're doing now, that my wife Heidi is producing, is going to cost $6.2 million. When we did Big River, it was $2.5 million. Now, Big River was 1985, and when we did Big River at $2.5 million, we thought that was an unbelievable amount of money to spend.
So we're talking about an escalation way beyond cost of living, way beyond anything that's happened in other aspects.
I think so. I think costs have gone up as a result of labor agreements and so forth, but also as a result of the expectation that we have on Broadway, I think, now of a certain amount of scenic presence, of spectacle, a certain amount of stuff that people want to see for their $50 or $60.
Does this come about because of Cats and Les Miserables and Phantom of the Opera?
I think so. I'm not going to go on record necessarily saying Cameron McIntosh has ruined ruined Broadway, but I think that...
He's raised the stakes, though, hasn't he?
He sure has. There's a level of expectation now in the audience that we have to be responsive to and we have to be aware of. And I think without it, you have a problem. I think a good example of that is this the musical Once in This Island that's playing at the Booth, which is a musical that people seem to like. But on Broadway, there's a level of expectation that musical doesn't necessarily fulfill because of what it is scenically and in terms of all of the, you know, the Broadway stuff. And I think that's more and more the expectation.
But you still have the same problem. You have a new problem, which is raised expectations in terms of the visual and spectacular side. But there is still the need for content and substance, because let's take...
That's the second thing.
That's right, because let's take a show that was on and was quite spectacular, Shogun, the huge Japanese spectacular, which had incredible scenic effects, and yet it didn't succeed.
Right, so you walk out whistling the scenery.
That's right. And so you still, despite the fact that you need these mammoth productions, you can't escape the fact that people still want a worthwhile show.
You need to still have the quality of the product, and that's the other thing that's hard to find. There's a school of thought, Jerry Schoenfeld subscribes to it, and I think he's right.
Of the Schubert Organization.
Yes, that if you have the product, if you have something that's really worthwhile, you can get the show capitalized and get people to see it, even now. And there is a shortage of product. There's no doubt about it. And a lot of the people who would be working in the theater are working in television and the movies, and that's something that's a long-term problem that's not going to be easily solved.
Let me ask you, Rocco, what can be done about both of these problems? Let's take the economic burden and the problems of the cost of a show and raising capital. Are we in a no-win situation?
I think good, diligent producers can help to keep the costs down. One of the main things a producer has to do is to be able to say no to the members of the creative team who are asking him for things. It's something we encounter all the time. And the easiest thing is to say yes and to be convinced why something is necessary.
Do you mean
a good producer will say no.
You mean to the director, the scene designer,
exactly.
The costume designer,
exactly.
The lighting designer?
Of course, with The Secret Garden, we've got a problem that the scenic designer is also the producer.
And your wife.
and my wife, so there's quite a conflict of interest.
But she's probably pretty cost-conscious.
She's pretty good. She is. And I think good producing can go a long way toward addressing this problem. I don't think you can do a situation where you simply get all of the creative elements together, ask them what everything is going to cost, and then budget the musical accordingly, or the play. I think you've got to do what we did with Big River, which is say, this is what it's going to cost, this is the money we've got to spend. It's $2.5 million, and we'll figure out how we can spend that money the best way we can.
Everybody has to work within those limitations.
Exactly. I think it's a much better way of producing.
And that could still be done, couldn't it?
I think it can, and should be.
Except one of the things that's happened in this in the last 15, 20 years is we've lost more and more independent producers, haven't we?
Because it's become such a struggle to get the shows capitalized, to get people to put money into them and get them to run successfully. A lot of them have gone out to work in movies and television.
What would be a scenario, just stick with the economic side for just a moment, what would be a scenario that 5-10 years from now things could be better? Better labor contracts?
If we can maintain some control over our costs, there'll always be an interest in doing theater, I think, because it's still the easiest way to make a big splash in this culture for the least amount of investment and time. I think people will always be drawn to the theater.
You think that's still true?
I think that's still
more
true.
More so than movies, rock music, everything?
I do. You can be going along, and like Tyne Daly was, and suddenly, because you're in a Broadway musical, change utterly people's perceptions of you, change your whole career.
She was in Gypsy, we should say,
yes,
and
yes.
In one of your theaters.
Otherwise, why would I mention it? But I still think...
But she was known primarily as a television actress, and then suddenly she became a Broadway star.
Exactly, and I think that can still happen in the theater. A producer, a director can arrive overnight in the theater in a way that doesn't work in a movie, which takes years and years to make and to develop a reputation.
Yes.
The theater has a kind of instant gratification that I think is very appealing to people. And if we can simply keep our costs under control, I think we can still attract people to the live theater.
Tell me this. What about, you mentioned getting new plays, new musicals. What is going to happen? Is it all going to fall into the hands of, in terms of straight plays I'm speaking of now, to the regional theater? Is that where everything's going to begin?
I hope not. We've commissioned a bunch of plays.
You have?
We have it at Jew Jamson from some of the top playwrights in the country. And I'm hoping that we're going to get people in the habit of writing for Broadway again, not just writing a play and hoping it'll get some production, but writing it with the expectation that we're going to try to do this play on Broadway. It can't be just up to the resident theaters.
You then, in the case of commissioning these plays, if you get a play you like, you might try it out or might have it done first in a regional theater, but the origination and the ultimate destination would be Broadway.
Exactly. And I think the idea behind this is that Broadway is still the one place where a playwright can make a living. You can, if you're a playwright, you can get your plays done in resident theaters, and maybe you can get two or three productions. It's very hard to survive that way. Broadway is still the arena where a playwright can make money and to support himself, and to the point where he doesn't have to go and write two or three screenplays for Hollywood.
Well, just
producers.
Out of curiosity, because I haven't asked this question of anybody in years, what can a playwright with a successful play on Broadway, what can he or she earn in the present structure of things?
Oh, a lot. $15,000-$20,000 a week. Yes.
Well, that sure to keep groceries on the shelf and put food on the table, I would think.
Exactly. I mean, the people who think that Broadway is a complete is a dinosaur and no longer necessary, I wish they'd be aware of what it takes to support a working playwright, and they really can't do it in the resident theaters. Nor can designers, for that matter, and directors. I think we need a commercial theater to be able to pay people a decent wage to keep them working in the theater at all. And that's very important.
What about now? You've got your five theaters that you operate. The overall population in terms of Broadway theaters in recent years, they've been only half of them have been filled a lot of the time. Isn't that true?
True. Some of them are problematic theaters to begin with. Their configuration is a problem in one way or another. And there have been too few plays in the musicals.
Let me stop on that for 1 second, because one of your theaters is the St. James, where Gypsy played. Mm-hmm. And I remember you told me once that it had a second balcony, and so that made it a real problem. But did Gypsy disprove that problem? Or?
Well, for a while it did, but what always happens at a certain point when the show stops selling out, you stop selling that second balcony. Seating location, for some reason, has become more and more important to the audience. They want to be on the floor. So producers look to theaters to see which theaters have the most seats on the floor. And we can sell the second balcony if we sell them for $5, but it's very hard to make a reasonable profit on a show with a second balcony if you're not selling out.
Let me mention several other factors in terms of theater production these days. The critics. Are they a problem for people producing in the theater?
Well, I was trained as one, as you know. So
yes, I know.
So I probably have an ambivalent attitude toward them. My own view is that taken on balance, the critics are helpful to the theater because they educate the audience. They are enlightened opinion, whereas in other works of art that I can think of where the opinion of critics doesn't matter at all, I think there's a much lower level, you go down to a much lower common denominator in terms of the level of taste and acceptance. I think to the extent that the theater depends more on critics than other art forms do, I think that might be in its favor in the long run. Although, of course, we all get exasperated when you don't like one or another of our shows. But I think on balance, the critics are very important and helpful to us.
Well, but we really should mention the in New York, you do have, I mean, there's no point in avoiding
it. I'd like to put it on you personally.
We should say the New York Times.
Yes.
Do you think that there's a disproportionate power there? Forgetting about, whoever occupies the position of critic of the New York Times, because it seems to have such an influence.
Well, that's not something that the critic of the Times ever intends.
No, I
think that critic would like to have less power to open and close shows. But given the power of the New York Times itself, I think that's something that we have to live with. Yes, I wish that there were six or seven important papers in New York, like the situation in London,
yes,
where there was a spectrum of critical opinion. I think even the Times critic, I think Frank Rich would rather have that situation as well. But we don't have it, and we have to live with the situation we have.
You know, one of the things that I wonder about, and I wonder if younger people in the theater, and quite honestly, Frank Rich, as the critic of the New York Times, might be one of these. My memory of theater when I was growing up and seeing a lot of New York theater was of this incredible mix of comedies, straight plays, historical plays, musicals, of course, but and a lot of just plays that the audience responded to that were really not major works, not things of great intellectual content. But I think that mix was tremendously important. I remember Harold Clurman talked about in one of his articles, the critic Harold Clurman, the importance of that, of having the sort of middle level and popular plays to support the really masterpieces that come along.
No question.
Don't you think that's a concept we may have lost?
Absolutely, yeah. That's the big problem now, is that we don't have the common run of shows that we used to have, those shows that would open and run a season or two. They wouldn't be big hits, but they'd provide a kind of bottom to theatrical activity that's very important. The big problem in the theater now is that there's no room for failure. You either have to be a mega hit or you go away. Costs are such and capitalizations of shows are so high that you've got to gear everything up for being a sensational hit, otherwise you're a failure. You need to have that, you know, that kind of run of shows that maybe aren't the best show ever written, but people will come to see it and they'll run their season. We need that and don't have it, and we've got to try to get that back. One of the things we're trying to do now with the Walter Kerr and two other theaters under this thing we've got going called the Broadway Alliance.
Yes, describe that, because that's, I think, perhaps offers a glimmer of hope in the whole situation.
We're trying to bring back exactly the thing you're talking about, where shows can be put on a play not for $1 million or $1.5 million, but for $400,000.
That's a ceiling, too, isn't it? I mean,
yes,
that's a cap.
We've legislated that. You cannot spend more than $400,000 in your capitalization. Your weekly running costs, instead of being $130,000, $140,000 a week, or $70,000 a week. And most importantly, maybe to the people watching us, the price is going to be $24 and not a penny above. So we're trying to scale everything back down to where you have on Broadway much more what we have now off Broadway, which is a kind of bubbling up of activity, and shows that can go without being monster mega hits.
My understanding is that to arrive at this Broadway Alliance, and of course the jury's still out on whether that's
yes.
going to work or not, but people are certainly hopeful who care about the theater. But my understanding is that there was an unprecedented give and take on the part of the unions as well as producers to arrive at this agreement.
It's the first time in my knowledge that everyone got together and actually got along with each other and worked out some common a common plan.
Didn't everyone agree to take
yes,
cuts?
Yes, everyone agreed to take cuts. The minimum cuts were 25%. Some people took 50%. We took 100% cut in rent. We're charging no rent in the theaters for these shows.
For those
zero.
Particular shows?
Yes, zero, nothing. We're,
is the idea
we're getting our, you know, the electricity paid for, utilities, but we're charging no rent. And everyone has pitched in. Everyone has made sacrifices to make this thing work. In some cases, painful sacrifices. But the feeling was that unless everybody got together and really pitched in and made an effort to make this thing go, it wouldn't work.
So I think they've got to try that plus every other possible approach, don't you, to make this thing to bring it back. Because as you say, audiences demonstrate over and over again they would like to go to the theater. What do you think about young people, getting young people into the theater? What's the answer there?
I think discounting is very important there. I think making it price attractive is important. I mean, it seems obvious to me that the audience down at the public theater and off-Broadway in general is a much younger audience than we're getting on Broadway. That has to be a function of price as well as location.
Right.
And I think we have to address that by having a lower ticket price or finding some way for students or young people to come into the theaters at a discount. I think there will still be things on Broadway to attract them.
Rocco, you are, I must say, refreshingly outspoken about all kinds of things.
I'm usually getting in trouble for it.
No, but you did write an article, and I don't know whether how you feel about it now. You wrote an article questioning Lincoln Center's approach to the theater in terms of whether they were really acting like another commercial producer, even though they are supposed to be not-for-profit. Do you still feel that was what that article was a year or so ago? Do you still feel that way about that theater and other not-for-profit theaters? Or?
Well, many of them. I think what Lincoln Center has been about is producing shows, which is what we're doing.
What commercial?
Of course, they're doing it, in many cases, on Broadway with a subsidy, which we don't have, which I think is not fair.
Is unfair competition.
Yes. And of course, they're getting a lot of attention because they are on Broadway and they're in New York. I think there are a lot of resident, or not a lot, but there, right, in fact, not enough. But there are some resident theaters throughout the country that are simply doing their work as they see that it should be done. They're not looking to move things onto Broadway. They're not looking to gain a lot of recognition in New York. They're doing the work that they feel is important and keeping their own artistic identity and integrity. And I think those theaters should be celebrated and acknowledged by the audiences and by the funding sources. I think that would be important.
But do you think there are other theaters that very much have one eye on the Broadway theater and the commercial theater?
I don't think there's any doubt about it. And it's such a seduction. I mean, who wouldn't be? You know, you find that you get written up in Time and Newsweek. Your board members notice that you've had a show running on Broadway. You get income from the show running on Broadway. It's very hard then when you're sitting down to pick a play not to say, wait, this might have a commercial transfer. Maybe this could have a life in New York. It's very hard for an artistic director to not think that way. And the ones that do, the few that are left, I think,
but
I admire them.
It's very seductive, though, that pull that you're talking about. But there's always the constant danger that the tail will wag the dog. That is, they'll be thinking so much about a transfer, they really lose sight of the local theater audience and their own artistic mission.
Exactly. They've got to remember they're in a community in which they are the theater. They're not a way station to someplace else. And they presumably have an artistic mission of their own.
Speaking of an artistic mission, because we don't have a lot of time, but I do want to mention one show that you were very involved in personally and your theater group and a lot of producers, Grapes of Wrath,
yes.
Which you brought to Broadway.
Show.
And there's a case where that's the kind of show that might have been a regional theater show, but you really very much wanted that on Broadway, didn't you?
It was a regional theater show. I just felt that it should be seen by more people, which is what Broadway means. And we lost our investment in that show, and if I had to do it again, I'd do it again in a second. I was so proud of what the Grapes of Wrath was, and so was the Schubert Organization, who co-produced it in the court. I think we all just felt happy to be associated with something so extraordinary, and I'd do it again in a second, no matter what it cost.
Do you get many surprises? Now, I think you probably thought that won a Tony Award, that would have done better commercially, maybe, particularly after winning the Tony Award. On the other hand,
people didn't want to see it. Is Samuel Goldwyn had the expression of people don't want to see a movie, you can't stop them? they didn't want to see Grapes of Wrath, and we couldn't stop them.
Couldn't stop them.
Right.
On the other hand, you had a show like City of Angels. Did that surprise you that was the big hit that it became?
Yes. If you would ask, that show came together very late in previews. And if you had asked me a week before that show opened, was it going to be a hit on Broadway, you know, I would have looked at you cockeyed. I didn't think it was going to make it. Of course, the creative team on that show is aware that I didn't think it was going to make it at that time. I think they're mad at me to this day. It came together very late,
and fortunately.
But of course, that's one of the
marvelous things about the theater. On that happy note, Rocco, our time is up. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks,
My
Ed.
Guest has been Rocco Landesman. This has been Spotlight. Thank you for being with us.